Welcome to the Rancho Mirage Public Library. My name is Susan Cook, and I am the principal librarian here at the library. If you have your cell phones on you today, if you could be sure that those are turned off for the enjoyment of us all. As a librarian, I'm always curious to hear how people read books. So in this audience, how many people read print books? Whoa. Okay. How many people read electronic books? Okay. So here's the real question. How many read both? That's interesting. I'm not sure if I gathered all that, but anyway, you're all reading, so that's the important thing. It's my pleasure to introduce, and first of all, I want to say that the library and the Library Foundation is very appreciative of the generosity of the Literary Society of the Desert financial support for today's program. Please give them a nice thank you. It is collaborations like this that make our desert such a special community. And I also want to give a thanks to our Library Foundation for their time and effort and support that they give the library all year long. And I know some of those folks are here today too. So please give the Library Foundation a nice thank you. It's my pleasure to introduce Nancy Cunningham, President of the Literary Society of the Desert, who will introduce our author and speaker today. Nancy is the founder of the Literary Society of the Desert, which brings some of today's most important and respected authors to the desert for their group's literary luncheons, which is now in its third year. Second year, okay. Time doesn't go that fast. She has served on the Rancho Mirage Library Foundation, is founder of the Palm Springs Architectural Desert Museum, and is an active in the McCallum Muses. So we have Nancy to thank for this program today, and we all appreciate you turning out and coming today. Please give Nancy a nice warm welcome.
Thank you, Susan, and thank all of you for being here this afternoon. The Literary Society of the Desert is very, very proud to be here at this fabulous public library. And as Susan was saying, one of the most interesting things about this library, although it is a public institution, the events such as today are all privately sponsored and privately funded. So it is very important for all of us to be patrons of this important institution. And I thank you for being here. And we are very, very proud to be presenting Douglas Smith. About 6 months ago, I first learned that his book, Rasputin, was going to be published and started trying to learn more about Dr. Smith and more about the potential book. He is an award-winning historian and translator. He holds a PhD from UCLA. He's been a Fulbright scholar, held a residency at Rockefeller Foundation's Bellagio Study Center, has taught and lectured in the United States and Europe. He's published widely, written 5 books on Russian history, most notably Rasputin, which was published in November. And a flurry of emails went back and forth after we made the decision to co-sponsor this program at the library. And the book dropped, I guess, in publishing terms, in very early November. And about 2 days later, as I'm picking up my mail, there it was on the cover of the New York Review of Books. And I was jumping up and down because we were going to be presenting this program in February. He had a magnificent 2-page review inside that publication. And then not even a week later, the Wall Street Journal is calling this brand new book the definitive biography of Rasputin. So we are so proud to have Dr. Smith here today representing the Literary Society of the Desert and speaking at this library. I want to let you know that his book is for sale in the back of the room, and he is proud to say it is already in its 4th printing. So it's been extremely well received, although it's only been out for a few months. So it's with great pride and pleasure and gratitude to Doug Smith for being here with us today. So please join me in giving him a really warm welcome.
Thank you, Nancy, for that warm welcome. Wow, nice turnout. I live in Seattle. If we had a day like this, no one would be here but me. So thank you. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Nancy, for that introduction. Thanks to the Literary Society of the Desert for hosting this wonderful event. To Barnes & Noble for being here to sell the book. To you all for showing up. This event combines things that I love. Libraries, bookstores, new friends, old friends, family. So it's a wonderful day. The only thing missing for me would be a Russian archive, but I don't think we can swing that today. Finally, I have to thank my mother. Where is she? Right there in the front row, Annette C. Smith. Everyone. No one has ever had a better publicist than my mother, and I'm very grateful for all her support. I think my other publicist with my publisher in New York sometimes feels he's not pulling his weight. So it's good. I keep saying, well, you just got to do as well as my mother, and you'll be fine. I also want to thank Dustin in the back for all of his technical help, so we got all this taken care of. I'm going to speak for about 3 hours. And then there's a quiz. No, I like to speak for about 25, 30 minutes, and then I'm going to open it up to any questions you might have, and then we'll have a book signing in the back for you. It was just over 100 years ago, last December, that one of the most remarkable murders of the 20th century took place. On December 30th, 1916, Rasputin was invited to the home of Prince Felix Yusupov. He was met by a gang of killers. You've all heard the story, of course. He was impossible to kill, right? They tried to poison him. They tried to beat him. They tried to stab him. They tried to shoot him. But nothing would kill the Satan Rasputin. Finally, they dumped his body in the icy waters of a branch of the Neva River in Petrograd, the capital of Russia. Several days later, his lifeless corpse, as you see here, was pulled from the water, his body having been thrown from that bridge in the background. The murderers included Prince Felix Yusupov, one of the wealthiest and most connected aristocratic men in Russia. Joining him was Grand Duke Dmitry Pavlovich, cousin of the Tsar, and a right-wing politician by the name of Vladimir Putiskevich. Now, they all had somewhat different motives for killing Rasputin, but they all thought of themselves as true Russian patriots. After two terrible years of World War I, in which Russia had suffered horrific losses and defeats, many came to believe that the country was being sold out by German spies and traitors. And many came to believe that the man at the center of this network of traitors was none other than Rasputin. They believed that by murdering Rasputin, they would upset the German spy networks, thus freeing Tsar Nicholas to act competently and without interference and lead Russia into a period of victory over the Germans and Austrians and thus save the imperial dynasty. But in fact, the opposite happened. The murder of Rasputin, the murder of the man Nicholas and Alexandra called our friend, only sped up the forces of disruption and anarchy in Russia. This did not save the monarchy. It helped to spell its doom. Within 3 months after the killing, the 300-year-old Romanov dynasty collapsed. As the Russian symbolist poet Alexander Blok said, quote, the bullet that killed Rasputin struck the very heart of the reigning dynasty. Grigory Yefimovich Rasputin, as he's called in Russia, was obviously one of the most famous and mysterious figures of the 20th century. He's somebody who, that, although he's been dead 100 years, simply does not seem to go away and still is full of life and fascination for millions around the world. Popular culture is littered with Rasputins. You're a bit of a different generational audience than some of my other talks. You maybe don't know this one. But in the 1970s, the German band Boney M. had a huge disco hit that went like this. Ra Ra Rasputin, lover of the Russian queen. Ra Ra Rasputin, Russia's greatest love machine. Here they are performing it for you, complete with the Rasputin beard. While some of you maybe know this song, I bet very few, if anyone, knows another Rasputin song, my favorite, from 1933, by a group called the Three Keys here in the United States. The song was called Rasputin, that highfalutin loving man. It's the story of a crazy lover by the name of Rasputin Jones, and it includes this wonderful line from the lyrics, "Can't you tell he's from the South? See that gold mine in his mouth?" You can find that on CD, but you gotta look really hard. There are Rasputin bars, restaurants, cafes. There's a Rasputin music and record store in Berkeley, California. Also in California, there's a brewery that makes Rasputin Imperial Stout. And of course, you can find Rasputin vodka. Rasputin figures in comic books, in Japanese manga and anime. There's even a Rasputin opera. There are, of course, dozens of Rasputin movies. This is one of the more recent ones and one of the most poorly cast ones, I would say, starring the French actor Gerard Depardieu as Rasputin. One thing Rasputin was not was fat. This was clearly not the right choice here, and clearly one of the worst Rasputin movies, I would say. Some of you may remember the 1997 animated Warner Brothers movie called Anastasia, with this crazed green devil of a Rasputin. The story of Rasputin reads like a dark fairy tale. An obscure, uneducated peasant from the wilds of Siberia receives a calling from God and sets out in search of the true faith. A journey that leads him across the vast expanses of Russia for many years before finally bringing him to the palace of the Tsar. The royal family takes him in and is bewitched by his piety, his unerring insights into the human soul, and his simple peasant ways. Miraculously, he saves the life of the heir to the throne, but the presence of this outsider and the influence he wields with the Tsar and the Tsaritsa angers the great men of the realm, and they lure him into a trap and kill him. Many believe that the holy peasant had foreseen his death and prophesied that should anything happen to him, the Tsar would lose his throne. And so he does. And the kingdom he once ruled is plunged into unspeakable bloodletting and misery for years. Historians and biographers have been obsessed with Rasputin, the so-called mad monk or the holy devil, for decades. If you go online and check the catalog of our Library of Congress in DC, you'll see that there are already 153 books on Rasputin, now 154. He has not suffered from a lack of attention. Now, I had never really intended to write a book on Rasputin. It was never something that I had been planning, and I came to it sort of out of coincidence, if you will. I was working on my last book called Former People, which is the story of what happened to Russia's nobility after the revolutions of 1917. And during my research, I obviously had to do a great deal of reading about the final years of Tsarist Russia. And everywhere I looked, there was Rasputin. It didn't seem to matter what sort of source I was reading, there was this mysterious figure. Sort of piqued my curiosity. But still, I wasn't sure I really wanted to dig in too deeply. I started by reading some of the established canonical biographies of Rasputin, and I found that I didn't find any of them terribly satisfying. I didn't find the man that they were describing to be terribly believable. He seemed two-dimensional to me, sort of a caricature, more of a myth than a man, very much still this notion of the holy devil, if you will. And then I also found, as I was reading, that there's been an attempt in Russia in the last few years to reimagine Rasputin and to retell his story. And this is chiefly being done by Russian nationalist historians. And they, in a sense, have now decided to replace one myth for a new myth, namely that Rasputin was not Satan, he was not the devil, but that he, in fact, was a true saint, an unblemished holy man who has been unfairly maligned throughout history. So this left me wondering, well, though clearly there must be some sort of truth in between these two poles, the devil or the saint, that like all of us, he was a living, breathing figure full of good and bad, and there must be a more accurate way of describing who he was. Now, I'm somebody who loves archives and believes that the only way you can do really good history is to dig and dig for the things that other people have missed and to go back to the original sources. So I decided that if I was going to devote myself to studying Rasputin and writing a biography, that it wouldn't be enough to go to the libraries and reread what other people had already written and sort of recycle and retell old, established, long-established stories, but that I would have to go back to the archives. I had no idea when I started just how much work this was going to be. This book was 6 years of full-time research and writing. I ended up visiting 7 countries to look in museums, archives, and libraries. Obviously, Moscow and Petersburg, but also I traveled throughout Siberia, throughout Western Europe, the United Kingdom, and archives here in the United States. I uncovered a wealth of new material, things that no one had seen before and no one had known before, and also was able to finally dispel so many of the myths and legends that had swirled around Rasputin. And I just want to mention 2 of them. As I started my talk, there was a lot of belief in 1915-16 that Rasputin was a German spy. It was considered for a fact that Rasputin was getting top secret military information through Alexandra and Nicholas and then secretly communicating it to his masters back in Berlin. Now, this has been repeated in many, many biographies, and even one as late as 2004 was claiming that this was a fact. To me, it never seemed believable. From what I was finding in my readings, Rasputin was, if nothing else, very much a committed Russian monarchist and a true patriot. So I figured, well, there's only going to be one way to maybe definitively answer this, and that would be to go to Berlin and see if there are documents that in any way link Rasputin to the Germans during the war, something that no biographer had ever bothered to do. So I went and I spent a week in Berlin working in the archive, the political archive of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And sure enough, I was very pleasantly surprised to find tons of material on Rasputin from the war years. The Germans were obsessed with Rasputin. They were interviewing people throughout Western Europe in neutral countries like Switzerland and Sweden, Russian travelers, Russian businessmen, anyone they could speak to who might be able to shed light on what was going on back at the court in Petrograd. But what I came away with after spending a week reading all this material is they had no idea who Rasputin was and on whose side he was. Was he for the war or was he against the war? Did he want a separate peace with Germany, or did he want Russia to fight on? It was clear after spending a week with these materials that Rasputin had never been a spy of the Germans, and I was able to explode a myth that had been hanging over his biography for a century. Now, that's the way things go when the history gods smile down on you. It doesn't always go that smoothly. I also knew that I would need to get access to the Russian police files in Moscow. Throughout the last 10 years or so of his life, Rasputin was constantly surveilled by the Russian police, who took extensive notes on everywhere he went, everyone he saw, everyone he came in contact with was also followed, and dossiers compiled on them. And I knew that I really could not do a thorough and serious job without access to these files. So I started going to Moscow, to the archive that holds them there, the State Archive of the Russian Federation, one of the largest, if not the largest archive in Russia. And I would put in my request in the reading room to see these police files. And then I would come back the next day. Things don't always happen fast in Russian archives. And every day I would get a response. The files are with the director. And this went on for several visits to Moscow over the course of an entire year. And every time I would put in a request, I would get an answer. The files are with the director. When I would say, may I speak to the director? The answer was, the files are with the director. When I would say, could you ask the director if I might see them? The answer was, the files are with the director. I was getting very frustrated, wondering if I could even continue. Jump forward a few months, and I was giving a talk in the UK at a literary festival. And after it, a young woman came up to me and wanted to compliment me on my talk. I immediately detected a Russian accent. And we were chatting, and she said, well, what's your next book project? What are you working on? I said, well, I'm trying to write a biography of Rasputin, but it's stalled. I don't know what to do. There are these documents, these police file documents, and I can't seem to get them. And she said, well, what's the matter? And I said, well, they're in this archive, and you know they've been telling me for a year that they're with the director of the archive, and they won't let me see them. I mean, they're completely stonewalling me. And she said, well, what archive? I said, well, it's in Moscow. It's the State Archive of the Russian Federation. And she said, oh, the director's my godfather. And I just blanched. I almost fell to my knees, started hugging her legs. I said, you've got to be kidding me. Sergei Mironenko is your godfather? She goes, oh, yes, yeah, very close. She goes, I'll shoot him an email. Let him know you're going to be coming. I can't thank this woman enough. And sure enough, she sent an email to her godfather, and I went back to Moscow and was shown directly into the director's office. And there on his desk, piled from here up to about a yard or two, were the Russian police files on Rasputin. So we started talking and everything, we're chatting, and he keeps wanting to chat, and I'm kind of getting sweaty and staring at the files. And yeah, that's nice, but you know, that's nice, but. And he said, I'm happy to let you look at these, but you only get 2 days. No photocopies, no Xeroxing, no photographing with your telephone or your iPad or anything like that. So I sat for 2 days without moving, and I typed like mad, going through these police files, finding everything I could. And I found a lot of good stuff. Let me give you just one example. One of the iconic stories in the life of Rasputin, and this is a little bit R-rated, so bear with me, but it is the life of Rasputin, was in March of 1915, he traveled to Moscow. And while he was there, he went out one night with some friends to a restaurant called The Yar. And while he was there, he got wild and blindly drunk, began carrying on, making lewd advances to the females in the gypsy choir, upsetting all the other patrons in the restaurant, and then at one point jumped up on the table, dropped his pants and everything, began waving his privates around wildly, screaming, "This is the altar at which the Empress prays." He was carted off by the police, huge scandal ensued. And it's in every biography, and it is always brought forth as evidence of A, his debauchery, B, his drunkenness, and C, the incredible power he had over Nicholas and Alexandra, that he could behave in this manner, yet no one would dare touch him. Well, I'd had my doubts that this story was true. And what's amazing was I found in this list of files the police reports from his visit to Moscow. And sure enough, they followed him everywhere, every day, everything he did, everyone he met with, including his visit that night to the restaurant Yar. But there was something missing. He didn't get drunk. He didn't chase the girls in the gypsy choir. And he definitely did not drop his trousers. And there was no scandal. It was only, as was apparent from the documents, months later that the head of the police in Petrograd, who was determined to bring Rasputin down, had this story made up and had his employees in the police divisions in Moscow create bogus documents to create a bogus affair. The whole thing never happened. It was like one of these great aha moments for any biographer. But I had one problem. There was a British diplomat then serving in Moscow, a man by the name of Bruce Lockhart, who later published his memoirs in England. And in his memoirs, he claims that he was at the Yar that night, and he saw it all with his own eyes. Now, you know, little part of my brain was tempted to say, well, who's going to read the Lockhart memoir? We'll forget about that. But I'm scrupulous, and I said, okay, I can't be certain this whole event never happened until I figure out what is the story behind Lockhart's memoir. So I did a bit of research, and I found that, in fact, Lockhart had kept diaries during his stay in Russia. And his diaries ended up in the archive of the Palace of Westminster in London. So I made my way to London, requested his diaries, and there they were. All throughout the war years, he recorded where he was every single day, what he did, what he saw. And what was so wonderful for me to find was that in March 1915, when he claims he saw Rasputin waving himself around at the Yar, he was in Kiev. End of story. People lie. Be careful what you read. Another thing I like to do is not only hang out in the archives, but I'm a big believer in visiting places connected with the lives of my subjects. So I had to go out to Western Siberia to Pokrovskaya, which was the home village of Rasputin. The little village is still there. Sadly, his house is gone. But there's a little museum that I visited and everything. And I'm not always sure what I take away from visiting these places that are connected with my subject's life. I mean, there's something about just the landscape and the light and, you know, the trees and the river, for example, that runs through Pokrovskaya. That was all very important. But there was another thing that I took away from this trip, which I hadn't really thought about before. One of the things that was interesting about Rasputin that previous biographers have not talked a lot about is though he started out very much sort of among the Russian nationalists, even the very anti-Semitic Russian nationalists, in his later years he turned away from them and began to speak with great tolerance about other religious faiths, about Jews in the empire and also about Muslims in the empire. And while I had known this intellectually, that there were Muslims in Siberia, in fact, that Islam came to Siberia well before Russian Christianity, Orthodox Christianity came, it was only when I was in a car driving out to Pokrovskaya, to Rasputin's hometown, and we were passing village after village with mosques and minarets, that I really sort of came to understand that, of course, he grew up in a world with different faiths, where his Christian village was the neighbor of a Muslim village, and he got along and they got along, and this very much shaped his thinking about religion and about tolerance and that sort of thing. So that's why one reason it's really important, I think, to visit these places connected with someone's life. This is the Rasputin Museum, which is across the street from where Rasputin's house used to be. It was torn down under Boris Yeltsin about 30, 40 years ago. I had a great tour of the museum. That's me. They had this little chair there in the museum, and they insisted, the husband and wife who run this museum, they insisted that I sit in it. They claim it had been in Rasputin's house, and that any man who sat in it would be guaranteed lifelong virility. So I could not pass that up. In Petersburg, I went to the building where he lived in the last year or so of his life. This is 64 Gorokhovaya Street, right in the center. I tried to get inside. It's not like England. If you've been to London with the blue plaques, there's nothing there. The only thing that would lead you to believe there's a connection to Rasputin is there in the lower kind of left of the front gate there was the Rasputin hair salon. But I found my way in when somebody was leaving. They left the gate open. So I got in and I went up the stairs to the third floor to apartment 20, which was his apartment. And I want to claim that I knocked and I went in and it was weird, but actually there was nobody there. And but I did stand around for a while and to try to, you know, imagine what it must have been like with Rasputin going up and down and all the people that came to him in his later years seeking help and favors. Of course, in Petersburg, I had to go to the Yusupov Palace, to the cellar where the gruesome murder took place. That's me on the right. I have some lovely wax figurines down there of Rasputin and the table, you know, with the poisoned cakes and the poisoned wine and what have you. And then upstairs in the courtyard, it was through this door that Rasputin most likely fled, already having been shot at least once or twice, across this courtyard that's sort of forgotten right there in that area where it's not kept up. What's interesting now is that courtyard belongs to a kindergarten. And you can see little children out there playing on their jungle gyms and their swings and that sort of thing, obviously totally unaware that they are playing in the space that is connected to one of the most notorious murders in 20th century history. I went out to Tsarskoye Selo, the Tsar's palace outside Petersburg, in an attempt to sort of dig around and see where exactly he was buried. This is a shrine that some sort of amateur historians and Rasputin followers put up where they insist his grave was. This was a woman who was there, the only other person who was there the day I arrived, and she was sobbing uncontrollably. And finally, I went up to her and I said, "I'm sorry, but are you okay?" And she kept saying, "There's no way we can pay, there's no way we can repay the sins that weigh on us Russians for the murder of Grigory Rasputin," and she was going on and on and on. And I didn't have the heart to tell her that, in fact, that was probably the wrong spot for his grave, that, in fact, it was out in a nearby field. And I went out there and walked around. I don't know what I was hoping to find. I don't know, some bone or something like that, but it's all since gone. This is a photograph of Rasputin taken in the palace. The bottom row you have left to right, the Grand Duchess Maria, and then Tatiana, and a nursemaid by the name of Maria Vishnyakova. In the middle you have Anastasia, the Tsarevich Alexei, obviously our hero Rasputin, the Empress Alexandra, and in the back row is Grand Duchess Olga. So what have I found after 6 years of researching and traveling and writing and reflecting? What is new in this take on Rasputin that isn't in the 153 other books in the Library of Congress that have already been written? I think what I have accomplished, or I hope that I've accomplished, is to get us away from the simplistic formulas of holy monk, holy devil, that he was neither the devil nor was he a saint. I tried not to airbrush out his less savory sides. He did drink heavily in his later years and was basically a functioning alcoholic. He womanized constantly. He was a terrible groper. He could never seem to keep his hands off any woman who got close to him. He had a temper, and he would rage, even in the presence of the Tsar, and bang his fists on the table. There was a certain vanity about him and a great deal of ambition. But what's interesting is he was never greedy. Money never interested him. And a lot of people put money in his hands, hoping to bribe him for favors from the Tsar. And as soon as that money would come into his hand, he would just as quickly turn it around and give it to somebody who had come for him with a terrible sob story about, you know, needing money for a train ticket or to help a poor relative. Money simply flowed right through him. He didn't acquire great property, no palaces. He didn't seek aristocratic titles. He never broke his roots to Pokrovskaya, to his village, and he never severed his roots to the peasant class, and was very proud of that fact. He spent much of every year back there with his family, and even in a weird sort of way, I would argue that he was a good family man. Adulterer notwithstanding, he did see to it that his wife Praskovya was cared for, always had two women that helped her when he was away. He took good care of his children. He had a son and two daughters. He made sure that both daughters were given the best possible education. He was very careful about who they dated, and he tried to sort of arrange for them the most appropriate and respectable suitors. When his son Dmitri was drafted in the First World War, Rasputin was horror-struck that he would lose his only son and did what he could to make sure that he was not stationed at the front. He was also truly a man who believed in the Bible and truly took the teachings of the Gospels to heart. I mentioned one, his religious tolerance, that extended to Jews and Muslims and to other believers. And he was also very much someone who believed the teaching that thou shalt not kill. This wasn't something that he found a way around. And I'll give you just one example. At Yale University in the Beinecke Rare Book Room is a remarkable letter that Rasputin wrote in the summer of 1914 to Tsar Nicholas. Rasputin had been back home in Pokrovskaya, was walking down the main street when a strange-looking woman came up to him. Her face was completely veiled, and she looked to be holding out her hand as if she were a beggar. And he was reaching into his pocket for his coin purse and was going to give her some money when she pulled out a dagger about that long and plunged it directly into his stomach, nearly killing him. He ended up in the hospital, miraculously surviving, and while he was recovering, Europe was racing towards the beginning of World War I. And Rasputin was horrified at that prospect. And he wrote an amazing letter that summer to Nicholas, begging him not to listen to the voices for war, to stay out of war, that war goes against God's teaching, and that if they were to go that direction, he saw nothing but darkness, chaos, and absolute grief and misery. And I keep thinking, what if the Tsar had listened to him? History would have been very different. Another thing I came away with is that the standard interpretation is of a debauched, vile, corrupt, dirty peasant arriving in Petersburg from the hinterlands and spreading his debauchery and his immorality among the pure ways of the capital. But what I came away with was a very different interpretation. In a way, it was the other way around. It was the capital and the high living and the loose morals, if you will, of the elite in Petersburg that in fact helped to corrupt and bring down Rasputin. And that takes us back to the murder. Prince Yusupov only once spoke honestly, in my opinion, about what happened that night at the palace. It was when he called, quote, killing Rasputin a cowardly crime, for that is exactly what it was. A group of men lured an innocent, unarmed, unsuspecting man to a party and murdered him. Now, we know about the story of Rasputin's murder from the memoirs of Prince Felix Yusupov. And these memoirs have always been taken on face value, that Rasputin was Satan himself, who was basically impossible to kill, which thus means then that Prince Yusupov is the Archangel Michael, leading God's armies against Satan's forces in the Book of Revelation. But what I found amazing in thinking about this is, since when do we take the testimony of a murderer at face value? Since when are we to believe the words of a cold-blooded killer? In my opinion, something very different happened that night in the Yusupov Palace, something that would reflect much differently on Yusupov and his place in history. For that, though, you'll have to read the book. Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to happy to take some questions for about 10, 15 minutes or so, and then meet you all in the back for anyone who's interested in a book. Yes, in the yellow.
Yes, I wore this so you'd notice me. I'm from Toronto, Canada, where the Tsar's sister, Olga, lived out her final years and died and was buried there. I explains his whole presence in the royal family.
Right, the question is, I'll repeat it just so everybody can hear better. Thank you, and very well done with the yellow. It caught my eye immediately. You know, a big part of Rasputin's story is his relationship with Alexei, the heir to the throne, who, as you know, had hemophilia. Trying to figure out Rasputin's ability to, in some ways, treat Alexei was very difficult. First of all, one thing that is clear, he never cured Alexei. He had hemophilia his entire short life until he was murdered in Yekaterinburg along with the rest of the family. However, he never died while Rasputin was around. So there is this question of, was Rasputin able to keep the boy alive and lessen his suffering? When I started thinking about this, I wasn't really sure how I was going to go about answering the question. Some people talk about peasants being able to speak the blood, to sort of rub, you know, the calf of a bleeding animal or something like that, and sort of calming the bleeding and making it stop. Some argue that it was through the power of prayer that he was able to lessen the suffering and ease the pain and stop the hemorrhaging of the young boy. I ended up reading a good deal about some of the cutting edge science that's being done in the mind-body field, if you will. Only now are scientists starting to better understand the degree to which physical health is controlled by the mind. And there's an amazing book, thank you. But there's Harvard has a center, UCLA has a center. I just read an article, a fascinating article in the opinion section of the New York Times about how they're finding that people who go to get treatments for various ailments in which the doctors do not speak to the patients do not recover nearly as fast as when the doctor speaks to the patients, listens to the patients, cultivates some sort of a human bond and relationship, the degree to which that helps healing. And ultimately, I think that is what was going on with Rasputin and the boy. That was very much, I mean, to call it placebo effect is too mild. There's something else going on, and we don't really fully understand it. But he, in some weird way, convinced the boy and his mother, which was hugely important, that he was not going to die and that he would get better. And I think he convinced the mother through his profound charisma and knowledge of the Bible, and her belief, combined with Rasputin's belief, literally would sort of will the boy back to some sort of normal state. That's the best I can do, but I talk about it more in the book. Uh-huh. Yes, right here, Minnesota. That's where I'm from. Good.
A follow-up question on the children. What is your take on Anastasia?
Oh, what is my take on Anastasia, the youngest daughter of four of Nicholas and Alexander? By that, I'm assuming you mean, did she die or did she not die? They all died. It's nice to believe that somebody got out, but they all died. No one got out of there alive. Way in the back.
Yes, thank you. When and how would a peasant from Siberia get to interact with the royal family? I mean, that seems rather strange.
Right, it is. Like, the question is, how does an illiterate peasant from a tiny village in Siberia end up making his way to the royal palace and being presented to the emperor and the empress of Russia? As I said, it sounds like a fairy tale, right? It doesn't seem believable or in any way possible. And even after 6 years of researching and writing, I still don't see how it could have happened. Rasputin had a religious experience of some sort when he was in his mid-late 20s, and he became what the Russians call a strannik, which is a holy pilgrim. And there was about 1 million of these holy pilgrims in Russia around 1900. And what he did is he would go off for extended periods barefoot, often in fetters, walking across the vast expanses of the empire, going from church to church, monastery to monastery, in search of religious and spiritual enlightenment. And if you will, these years of wandering became Rasputin's university. And he became infinitely attuned to human nature through his experiences with all sorts of people as he traveled, often criminals, other peasants, farmers, bureaucrats, bishops, and he developed a great way of sort of reading people. He also learned the scriptures practically by heart, and he had this rare ability to cite scripture and imbue it also with sort of folk peasant wisdom, and do it in a way that seemed full of life and vibrant and alive, unlike many of the priests who sort of spoke in a dry, scholastic, sort of dead way about faith and religion and belief. And over time, as he traveled, his fame, if you will, began to spread. And so he would go to one monastery and they would be so taken with him, the bishops would send him to another one with a letter of recommendation. Eventually, around 1904, 1905, he makes his way to Petersburg, and he wows several of the top bishops there. And they know that Nicholas and Alexandra are interested in these peasant holy men, because there were many of them, not just Rasputin. And through members of the extended Romanov family, Rasputin was brought to the palace in November of 1905 and presented to Nicholas and Alexandra. And we know that was the first meeting because Nicholas writes about it in his diary. And it's clear from that very first entry that they were very much impressed with him, with his personality, his knowledge, his way of being. And from that point on, they established this connection that lasts until his murder in 1916. Yes, right here.
Thank you. What is the connection today with Putin and the whole burial and the bones in the Russian Orthodox Church?
Right, the question is, what about the situation today with the remains of the royal family, their reburial in Petersburg? It's been a contentious issue, and I'm not an expert in this, but there was at least two sets of bones that the Russian Orthodox Church was not fully convinced belonged to members of the Holy Family, two of the family members. You know, it's a delicate thing, the question of the status of the royal family in the church, especially when you have, for example, the desire on one hand of Putin to bring the church back as one of the pillars of a new Russian national identity, when you also understand that he was the head of what had earlier been the KGB, you know, one of the pillars of the Soviet Union, of the communist state that helped, you know, destroy old Russia. So there's some tension between those opposing strains, if you will, in Russian history. Eventually, I'm not even sure, they may now all have been returned. I actually have not read something about it in a while, but I know that there has been some debate about that. There's also been debate about Rasputin, because there's a movement in Russia, not a big one, but there are people who say that, well, If Nicholas and Alexandra are martyrs of the church, are holy figures, and this was the one man they referred to as our friend and looked to for all religious guidance, and he was murdered, isn't he too then a holy martyr as well? And the church has actually looked into this and thought about canonizing Rasputin. But at the end of the day, they decided there had just been too many women and too much boozing, and they weren't quite ready to go that step. Let's see. Probably one or two more questions. Yes, right here.
I'm wondering, in your research, did you find conclusively or not that Rasputin had an illicit relationship with the Tsarina? And whether he did or didn't, did the Tsar's relationship with Rasputin stay firm throughout the whole period of time, mm-hmm. or was it just the Tsarina?
Yeah, good question. Two questions. First one, was there any proof that Rasputin had any sort of a physical relationship with the Tsarina, with Alexandra? I am 100% certain that there was never any physical relationship between the two of them. He had profound respect for the royal family. He was a true believer in the dynasty. He loved them and he viewed himself as a loyal subject. And if you read much about Alexandra and the kind of woman she was, she never, I think, would have even thought about something like that. And that's not to try to whitewash it. I think it's just anyone who really looks at their letters and looks at the sources says there's just no way that kind of thing happened. Now, that was one of the myths that was told about them, and was one of the lies that was used to tarnish the image of the throne, and that helped lead to his murder and helped lead to the downfall of the Romanovs. And then the second question, did Nicholas and Alexandra over the years maintain a similar attitude toward Rasputin? And I would argue no. Alexandra was more enthralled to Rasputin, was more convinced of his holiness, was more convinced that it was only through Rasputin that Nicholas remained on the throne. And to read the correspondence between Alexandra and Nicholas during the war when he is away at general headquarters is truly astonishing stuff, where she will literally write to Nicholas and say, you're meeting the generals tomorrow. Now you must be strong. Remember, our friend, as they called Rasputin, sent you a comb of his. You need to use this to comb your beard and to comb your hair before you go in to meet with the generals. For through our friend's comb, his power and will flow in you, and you will finally be able to resist the bad advice of your generals, and you will realize that all you need do is rely on the counsel of our friend. I mean, it's utterly the land of the wacko. And Nicholas was very, I grew up in Minnesota, which is sort of the land of you know, not taking things directly head on and passive aggression and things. He was sort of an honorary Minnesotan, I'd say. He just wouldn't engage with it. He'd go, oh, yes, dear, fine. He always said better, you know, 100 Rasputins than one hysterical fit of Alexandra. So he would just sort of prevaricate and say, no, I'm not dealing with that. All right, let's do one more, one more, or should we cut it? One final question. Yes, right here.
Can you tell us what you're working on now?
What I'm working on now. Good question. I have a couple books that I'm working on, and then I was making progress with those, and I, it's a big story, but I'll try to be real short with it. I was called to the house of a couple that had passed away a couple years ago outside Seattle. There was a pile of Russian material, and the people getting rid of all the family belongings didn't know what they were or what to do with them. Turns out that the man who died in advanced years had served as an assistant military attaché in Moscow in the U.S. Embassy under Stalin, and had taken thousands of color slide photographs, and had even filmed Stalin's funeral with a 16-millimeter color film camera. And all of this amazing stuff had laid hidden in his house for 60 years, and no one had ever seen it. So I've been digitizing that and starting to put some of it online. I'm going to be working with Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, and we're going to do documentaries and put out all these amazing images. So anyway, I got to go. Books are in the back. Thank you very much.